What's up, everybody? It's your boy, Head Coach Ross of the Tax Gym Street Warriors. The Street Warrior himself coming at you. Look, need to get at you because I had a interesting discussion earlier today. What was occurring was this. I was having a discussion with a couple of individuals that work in and around this secure facility that I'm in right now. And no, I can't tell you the name of the secure facility. It's one of those kind of facilities, all right? The upshot is this. In the midst of our discussions, you know, the latest doofusities of your President Trump and his attack on Syria, which is clearly, you know, a time-worn tactic to, you know, that corrupt and ruthless governments have used to distract the American populace from their failing domestic policies and their political stupidities by plunging the country into war. It's happened in the United States, it's happened in Portugal, it's happened in Brazil, it's happened everywhere that there have been stupid governments, which is pretty much everywhere on earth, okay? And so I was lambasting Trump, as you probably know, I tend to do. And then the subject, somebody interrupted, and the subject of Floyd Mayweather and Conor McGregor came up. If you wanted to see my full thoughts about that, please check out the video that I have, you know, regarding that whole topic. But I began to speak glowingly of Floyd Mayweather, lauding his intelligence, lauding the things that he has done. And that immediately drew a response from the others in the group. They said, how in the world could I, you know, pillory Trump as some kind of a mentally inept genetic mistake and credit Floyd Mayweather when he's been an ass in public? That's what they said. And they also said when he could barely read, you know, and you know, clearly Trump is smarter than Floyd, because Trump can read and Trump graduated from the elite Wharton School of Economics and all these other good things. And that's what brought me to the core of this discussion, something that my response, I decided I'd go ahead and break down and tell you about. Because there's a very, very, very large distinction between education and intelligence. And there are multiple forms of intelligences. Yeah, we'll get into those in just 1 second. But before we get into that, I'm gonna need you to hit that subscribe button. I'm going to need you to hit the like button. I'm going to need you to go visit my website, attacksgymcapoeira. Googlesites.com is in the link to this video. And we really, really need your support, okay? All right. Now, with that in mind, let's get into the rest of this discussion. Okay, like I said, I'm back at you. We're going to have to come over here and take a look-see at the rest of this discussion. Like I said, there's more than one form of intelligence. Let me turn you around here, okay? See that right there? In European sciences, there are about 9 types of intelligences, okay, that was defined. In Africa, my ancestors identified 15 forms of intelligences, but it's another discussion, we'll get to there later. We're going to focus on this 9 for the time being. All right, we're going to go through them, break them down, and we're going to do them in no particular order, okay? The first is naturalist, which is understanding living things and reading nature. Second would be musical intelligence, discerning sounds, their pitch, tone, rhythm, and timbre. Third would be the logical mathematical intelligence. You know that they're creating infographics, you know. That's quantifying things, making hypotheses, and proving them or disproving them. The fourth is the existential intelligence. As you can see through the meditating person, it's more like a spiritual kind of person. Tackling the questions of why we live and why we die. This is more philosophical, spiritual, all right? Then next is the interpersonal intelligence. As you can see by the sign here, you're sensing people's feelings and motives. Now we're moving on to the bodily kinesthetic intelligence, which is coordinating your mind with your body. This is very important. We'll come back to this in a minute. Next is the linguistic intelligence, which is what it sounds like. Finding the right words to express what you mean and having an aptitude toward words and languages, stuff like that. Okay. The next is the intra personal, intrapersonal intelligence, which is understanding of yourself, what you feel and what you want. And we see people like psychologists, psychiatrists, individuals like that, therapists, you know, who are inclined toward this kind of intelligence. And the last is the spatial intelligence, which allows you to visualize the world in 3D. And as you can see by the person here, that's pretty much what they do. Everyone from golfers to architects, various forms of engineers, specialists like physics specialists, things of people like that, okay? Now, I'm gonna give you a much better look. You can turn around and look at my handsome grill. There you go. All right. Hey, look at the handsomeness. Okay. Now, why is that important? Okay. Because out of all of the intelligences listed, we can pretty much clearly say that Trump, as a politician, as is shown here, he has interpersonal skills. And there is the idea that he is a good businessman, and it's therefore seems to have some kind of aptitude toward logical mathematical reasoning, which he seems to be sorely lacking, you know, in pretty much every form of public interaction we've seen thus far. But let's just credit him with that for the time being. And let's take a look-see at what his history is, okay? And Floyd is primarily known as a tremendous athlete, but he's also much more than that. Floyd has evinces the bodily kinesthetic intelligence and the logical mathematical intelligence and a 10th intelligence, one of the other 7 that my ancestors spoke about, which is the fluid intelligence, which is the capacity to read what is going on right now, recognize patterns right now, analyze, you know, and reach solutions based upon stimuli and information you're receiving right now, and then adjusting that information with previous information, current information, to make an accurate future forecast. That's how Floyd is able to adjust to all these different styles of boxers in the ring. And it's also how Floyd is able to craft his business decisions in such a way that each successive venture is more successful than the previous venture. Okay? All right, now. So, just saying what's up to one of the homies. All right. Yeah. Now, Trump was raised surrounded by riches. His father, Fred Trump, who, by the way, would not have been allowed into the country given his son Donald Trump's distinct antipathy toward immigrants. Fred Trump became a very, very rich man, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars through real estate investment. He also was investigated twice. For civil rights violations, he was a racist, and the other for legal and moral issues that involved the Justice Department. So, we already have a background of him being, you know, of Trump's family being successful, but not really being the most morally upright individuals in the universe. With that being said, let's take a look-see at Floyd. Floyd was raised in the rough and tumble times, the city of a Grand Rapids, Michigan. Grand Rapids, Michigan. And he was born in the late 1970s, I believe. And it was a tough time. It was a tough time in a very tough city where everybody was broke. In fact, you had to save up to be broke. That's how broke a brother was back then. And don't act like you don't know the broke brother blues, because we know the broke brother blues. And my sisters out here, a lot of us have been broke before. A lot of y'all have been broke before. So you know what it feels like to be sisters sans simoleons. You know what I'm talking about? So you already feel me here. Okay. Floyd, as a child, went through school, what have you, focused on boxing because of the brilliance of his father and his uncle. And then Floyd made the decision to drop out of high school. So he never completed high school. Instead, he saw that his family was really struggling. His grandmother supported his skills and his obsession with boxing. And by this time Floyd was in high school, he was already boxing, doing sparring training with really powerful names like Pernell Whitaker. Those of us who know anything about boxing know the sweet pea. That dude's defense, his boxing skills, his accuracy, incredible. He wasn't the strongest puncher in the world, but he had sharp punches. He was an amazing boxer. The other person that Floyd was training with as a teenager and giving good work with, it was Frankie Randall, the one who would go on to defeat Julio Cesar Chavez officially. Because by that time, of course, Julio Cesar Chavez had really lost twice. Because in real life, we all know that Pernell Whitaker beat Julio Cesar Chavez in the first get down. All right? If you disagree with that, put it in the comments and we can go at it. All right? Now, the reason why this is germane to discussion is because Floyd, as a child, was already doing well with outstanding, leading, dominating world champions in boxing. Okay? That's what gave him reason to believe that he would do well if he pursued boxing as a career. Therefore, that's what he did. That's what led him to drop out of school. And as we can see, $800 million later, he made the right decision. Floyd displayed significantly greater intelligence than Trump has, because Floyd came from nothing. Father in jail, his uncle wasn't really supporting too much, his mother was on drugs, his grandmother, was working, but she was at that time, and she had caught an injury, so she was on welfare. So basically, everybody had to break up. Everybody was broke, really broke. Floyd came from that to $800 million. Trump came from getting from a family that was worth hundreds of million dollars and receiving a multi-million-dollar stipend to push, cash from his father to start with, and then built an empire that was somewhere in the neighborhood of a hundred, half a billion dollars in gross work, gross net worth, to gross is GDP as it were. To approximately, the best pundits say he's generated about $3.5 billion in the real estate world, which is a very, very, very impressive thing to do if you believe the information you receive. I believe he's done a good job. He's ruthless enough, and his ego is humongous enough, and he's learned enough, I believe, to do very, very well under those circumstances. But compared to Floyd, no comparison. Floyd, without a high school education, was able to outsmart most of the people around him, all of whom had received tremendously elite education. Floyd is the leader of the Floyd of his of Floyd's all of Floyd's businesses. He's the leader of the money team. He's the leader of Mayweather Promotions, etc., so on and so forth. This kid without a high school education and who had to save up to be broke is now leading some of the most elite minds and business in the world. So, does it matter if he can read like, Obama? No. Don't make the mistake of thinking that his lack of reading skill is an indication of his lack of intelligence. Those of you, especially those of us from the street, you know about what I'm about to say right about now. A lot of you, period. A lot of people, period. No matter what your background is going to get me here. But those of us who have been in the hood or what have you, you're going to catch me on this one. We know a lot of people who hasn't graduated from nowhere, who are 100,000 times smarter than people who come back home from some school or another, university or another, with advanced college degrees, and that's it. My father used to refer to people who has this incredible comprehensive intelligence but didn't go to school. He would say that these people have advanced degrees in common sense. That's what we're talking about here. Real life intelligence, which is fluid intelligence. So when you add all these things together, what is the most important, the most foundational intelligence? The most foundational intelligence is the so-called bodily kinesthetic intelligence, what our ancestors called ekima akili mwili, which means the wisdom of mind and body. why is this germane to this discussion? Is it just, you know, is this a cool thing to say so you can have in your mind, know what to cultivate and be able to distinguish between somebody trying to fake you out and tell you what degrees they have, as if it's an indication that they're intelligent, when really it's an indication that they've completed a particular level of coursework at a particular level of performance? You know, am I railing against education? Hell no, I love education. Go get it. No matter what happens, once you get the education, it can't be taken from you. All right? Unless you get a lobotomy or something. Okay? So go get that education. Education is accurate information with which to feed and fine-tune your intelligence. But what you don't know is that training in Njia, Uhuru, CAPOEIRA is proven to improve your intelligence. Let you think about that. Now I want to get into it. I want to prove it to you. Because I heard you. Oh, no, it doesn't. You're just saying that to try to get us to watch your videos and do this to you. Yeah, right, bro. You should know me by now. I don't make these statements without comprehensive scientific data and its proof. What? You want to see it? Glad you said that, because that's what we're here for. So, here's the evidence I'm telling you about, okay? Now, let me turn you around here so you can see this. This is a picture of the cerebellum. As written by, lifted from an article written by Dr. Eric Jensen. He's one of the many, many experts in the field that we're about to discuss that have produced overwhelming evidence, inarguable evidence of the accuracy of what I'm about to tell you now. I want you to pay attention to the caption below the cerebellum. This is the cerebellum here. This is the rest of the brain. This is the cerebellum. The caption below reads, information travels to and from the cerebellum, which is that point right there, cerebellum, the brain's center of motor control. The cerebellum is the brain's center of motor control. And information travels to and from the cerebellum to other parts of the brain involved in learning. But most of the neural circuits are outbound. Now, why is this of such great importance? Well, I'm going to tell you why. That means very directly that the same part of our brain that is involved in learning movement is the part of our brain that is involved in learning, period. So as your movement skills become diversified and more intricate, so does your capacity to learn, and so does the actual intelligence you evince. That is of great importance. I'm about to build on that in just a moment, but I need you just to marinate on that. And I want you to understand that there's no questions about this. This has been established through the latest science, through the latest magnetic resonance imagery. It's of tremendous, tremendous, tremendous importance to all. I just have to reach over here and fix a couple of things while I'm talking to you. You know, I have to reach over here just past the camera to fix a couple of things, you know, so that camera doesn't tilt too much. Okay, what you need to understand is that type of information has been confirmed really since we've known that. Africans have known that forever. It's been at least 100,000 years, but it's been rediscovered and done in a previously impossible to confirm in this way type of information, because there was no such thing as MRIs, magnetic resonance imagery, 100,000 years ago. So the advances in science here have revealed more critical details along the path of knowledge that we had 100,000 years ago and had gotten lost and then was rediscovered and then expanded upon. All right? Okay. Now, the cerebellum is about a tenth of the size of the brain. It's pretty small compared to the rest of the brain. But it has about half or more of the neurons of the entire brain. The cerebellum is just crazy with this intense with how densely packed it is. So with neurons, which means that when you move and you train, the cerebellum and the brain in that order, you know, actually grows more neurons. It becomes more complicated, becomes more capable, which was a very hotly disputed topic, if whether or not the brain can grow more neurons, hotly disputed for decades. In fact, it was largely debunked as a hypothesis or theory for the longest, until MRIs began to establish data to the contrary. When the brain was subjected to movement. Why is that also important? Because when you move, you feed the brain's favorite food, which is oxygen. With oxygen, it has more energy to think, to calculate, to create, and to maintain focus. And then with added neurons, it does more, the added neurons that comes from the movement training that you have, it does more work with less effort and with greater powers of both specificity, meaning it can focus tightly on one issue, and generality, which means they can measure a number of different issues all at the same time. Okay? And it can do it for longer. All because you're doing movement training. So work out, exercise. Do healthy workout and exercises. Now, here's another question for you. Now that we know that movement training, exercising, etc., so on and so forth, does in fact help stimulate specifically and especially the bodily kinesthetic intelligence, the ekima akili mwili, which means the wisdom of mind and body in Swahili? Well, are there certain types of movements training that's better for you or develops the brain faster, the cerebellum and the brain faster and better than others? Yes, that's when you start running into more forms of layered science, more forms of intelligently selected and combined movements, exercises that give you a comprehensive, synergistic, as well as holistic result. I saw you. Half of y'all was like, the hell you just say? What that means is there's a way to get your exercise on in such a way that you get way more results that are in way more areas in way shorter periods of time. You got to do it in a particular order, and you have to do it in a particular way. Now, here's another important thing. Now, I want you to take this to your cardio capoeira mestre, especially your cardio capoeira mestre, all right? Because real talk, some of the most complex movers on earth are cardio capoeira people, gymnasts, dancers, decathletes, people like that, right? Others who are specialists who do one thing and one thing only well, they're not really the most comprehensive movers on earth. So while you will get some stimulus into your cerebellum, that stimulus will level off, because the complexity of the movement, the challenge associated with the movement, will begin to denigrate, or at least it will plateau off. Okay? And because your brain, you know, develops the neurons to make these movements work, and then grooves the muscles and tendons, etc., so on and so forth, in order to apply these movement skills at a rate that's commensurate with the thought processes that we have. And our thought processes are so fast that they're not even conscious thought processes. They're subconscious thought processes. The things that allow you to talk and breathe at the same time. Things that allow you to talk and pay attention to your environment at the same time. Your eyes are moving, hands are moving like I'm doing right now, like I'm casting a spell, hocus pocus, you love Njia, Uhuru, you love head coach Ross of a tax gym, that type of thing, all right? Well, we go beyond that. We use a very specific, goal-oriented type of program that combines the best of systemization with improvisation. Now, that's very, very, very important, okay? Improvisation compels you to think on the fly. It really works your fluid intelligence, which amplifies all the rest of the previous intelligences that we just talked about, all right? And it sits on top of, it's the second most important layer, sitting right on top of the bodily kinesthetic intelligence, that the ekima akili mwili. But your instructors don't know that. Your instructors, if your instructor is an expert, he, she, or they should be able to tell you why they do what they do, you know, in the order that they do it in, you know, and the guarantee results that you will achieve by doing what you're doing in the way that you're doing it, the way they're telling you to do it. And then they'll be able to justify why. Not only through self-defense and health and fitness reasons, but also through how it develops your brain, how it impacts you as a person. They can't tell you that. They can't tell you none of that, but I can. And not only that, I can guarantee you results in 45 seconds, you get your money back. Oh yeah, in black and white. That's how we street warriors roll. That's how the head coach Ross rolls. You know, we're able to guarantee these particular kinds of things that others who lack this kind of expertise simply cannot do. Oh yeah. So what I need you to do is go to my website, Taxi Gym Street Warrior Capoeira, googlesites.com. I need you to hit that like, subscribe on my YouTube. I'll need those comments on the YouTube. And I'm also going to need you to support us. Facebook, we have a group page, Capoeira Self-Defense That Works. Come check us out, please. We need you. All right? Take care of yourself. Asante sana. Ashe. Amani.